Today we will continue the discussion on differential equations, and this lecture is devoted to understanding one very basic concept, and that is, what do we mean exactly by the complete solution of a differential equation? Mind my words, complete solution. We have learnt that there is something called the general solution of a differential equation, and that general solution has as many independent arbitrary constants as the order of the equation. So, if we are handling a second order differential equation, whether it is linear or whether it is of higher degree, that means second order derivative is raised to the power of 2 or 3, whatever, the order of the equation still remains 2, and the general solution cannot contain more than 2 independent arbitrary constants. If it contains less than 2 independent arbitrary constants, it becomes a particular solution to that differential equation when we are talking about second order differential equations. So, we get back here, we are going to discuss what exactly is the meaning of a complete solution, and I have given a preamble that we first talk about the complementary function and denoted by y sub c. The complementary function satisfies the differential equation, and it is another name for that general solution or complete primitive. This solution, y complementary, will satisfy the differential equation, and this solution will have as many independent arbitrary constants as the order of the equation. The next class of solutions is called the particular integral or particular solution. It is denoted by y sub p, p for particular. Now, there are various methods of finding particular solutions, but I always say that if we find even by trial and error that a particular function satisfies this differential equation, the general form I have written down, then that is a particular solution provided we don't include any arbitrary constant in that solution, because the general solution part contains as many independent arbitrary constants as the order of the equation. A particular solution essentially is not derivable from the general solution and essentially is bereft of any constant, arbitrary constant. It might have a term 2 by 3, but it is bereft of arbitrary constants. So, if yc and yp individually satisfy this differential equation, then it stands to reason to say that if we take y as y complementary plus y particular, this term must satisfy, this expression must satisfy the equation, and this equation is satisfied by this complementary function plus particular integral. No constant combination, just the complementary function added to the particular integral becomes the complete solution of the differential equation. Now, mostly we start by handling differential equations which have the right hand side as 0. If we take an equation, let's see, let us take let the equation be now, this is a second order differential equation. It's linear because the second order, the highest derivative is raised to the power of 1. This can be written as d2y dx2 to the power of 1. So, this is a second order derivative, a differential equation, and the right hand side is 0. So we say that this is a homogeneous equation. Excuse me. So here is another way of using the term homogeneous. It's distinct. It's distinct and different from another usage of the homogeneous equation, which will appear in a separate lecture. But we can change this and convert it to a non-homogeneous equation by making the right-hand side equal to, say, fx. Then it's converted to a non-homogeneous equation. So when the right-hand side of such an equation is equal to 0, then we say that the equation is homogeneous. And when the right-hand side is not equal to 0, but fx, sum of us right is equal to capital X, where capital X is a function of X, then it is a non-homogeneous equation. And whereas the first equation with 0 has only the complementary function to handle, we will see that this kind of an equation, the second type, needs also a particular integral. And the general solution and the particular integral lead us to the complete solution of the equation. So we'll discuss further. We will now show how the particular solution of the particular integral is found. There are basically two important methods. They are very significant in the study of differential equations. The methods of finding particular solutions or particular integrals. One is the method of the variation of parameters. This is very important. And the second is a D operator method, or the D operator method, where actually, as we will see when we do it, D is an operator, that is ddx. If we are talking of x as the independent variable, then D stands for ddx. Sometimes in physical problems, problems from physics and engineering, D stands for dt, because in physics and engineering problems, practical problems, we need to find the variation of quantities with respect to time. So D stands in such cases for ddt. In other words, if we, for example, write operator, D operating on y is nothing but d dx of y. If we write d to y, it means nothing but d to y dx 2, and so on. So there is a particular way, or actually a series of formulas using the d operator, that will lead us to the particular solution. And these we will see separately. Right now, we start getting familiar with the method of the variation of parameters. So we will just write this particular, or discuss this particular method. Well, let the equation be of the second order. And let us write it of the form now. This is the very familiar second order differential equation with constant coefficients, and we have written it as a non-homogeneous equation because this x is not 0. Now we already know that the solution to this is in two stages. Number one, we find the complementary function, that means we solve the equation. First we solve. We write first step is to solve same equation making it homogeneous. On the right hand side we put 0. We also know that such an equation has something called an auxiliary equation. That means this comes from a trial solution that is assumed. Trial solution. E to the power of mx with a constant. If this trial solution, assuming that there is a solution like this, and we will find that there is actually, then we will see that there is an auxiliary equation which looks like m squared plus a1m plus a2 is equal to 0. There are three distinct cases where the roots are m1 and m2. If the roots are m1 and m2, the cases are one, m1 not equal to m2, and each belong to the set of real numbers. Two, m1 is equal to m2, and again m belongs to the real number set. The third case is, case number three is, m1 and m2 are complex numbers, and the theory of equations teaches us that complex roots occur in conjugate pairs. So we are motivated to write this as alpha plus minus I beta. So if we call m1 as alpha plus I beta, m2 is alpha minus I beta. Doesn't matter if we call m2 as alpha plus I beta and m1 as alpha minus I beta. It is immaterial. Now, assuming that we have found the complementary function, let us call the complementary function as the solutions. We will rub out a bit of it and write let the complementary function be c1 y1 plus c2 y2, where each of these y1 and y2 are solutions to the equation this is equal to 0. Mind you, we must remember that y1 and y2 are not solutions of the original equation, which has capital X, a function of X on the right, but y1 and y2 will satisfy this equation when the right hand side is 0. So this is the complementary function. It has as many independent arbitrary constants as the order of the equation, which is 2. Now we'll see what is the meaning of the variation of parameters. We'll explain the philosophy and then see how we can go further. Now, the variation of parameters method . The philosophy behind the process is that we assume the existence of two functions u and v, such that if c1 is replaced by u and c2 is replaced by v, then we get a particular solution. We assume that it is possible to find a particular solution by replacing c1 by u and c2 by v. So u y1 plus v y2, where u and v are functions to be chosen very carefully in order that we get home. So we will see what conditions must be imposed on the functions u and v such that this indeed becomes a particular solution. So I repeat once again, the philosophy is to look for a solution that replaces C1 by a function of x and C2 by a function of x as well. So we must emphasize where u and v are functions of x chosen appropriately. So that this appropriately has the connotation of we get home. That means we do indeed find a solution that satisfies the original equation. So I'm just writing we get home. That is, after all, the target. In any case, getting home in a football match is scoring a goal at the opponent's goal. So that is the target. So we try to do we try to find out exactly what conditions must we impose on u and v so that they are properly determinable. U and v are carefully chosen such that uy1 plus vy2 becomes a solution of now let us differentiate this particular solution first once, then twice, and substitute into this equation. So for that we will do one thing, we will take the equation on top, carry out the differentiation and see what emerges. This x is a function of small x. Upon carrying out the differentiation, we find that yp differentiated once is u dashed y1 plus u y1 dash v dash y2 plus v y2 dash. Now a little bit of clubbing and rearranging. If we take u y1 dashed and v y2 dashed here, so we have eaten up this term and we've eaten up this term, then we are left with nothing but u1 dashed y1 plus u1 dashed y1 this term, and what is left out is v1 dashed y2. So they are put here. That is equal to, that is the differentiation. Now, if we impose a condition that supposing we allow ourselves to choose u and v in such a way that this part vanishes. So, because we said that u and v have to be chosen carefully and appropriately, we first stipulate a condition that let us say that u and v are such chosen that u dashed y1 and v dashed y2 combine together to yield 0. So the first condition is this one. We write down that condition separately and hold it. Condition 1 to be imposed on u and v, that u dashed y1 plus b dashed y2 is 0. So we are left with the fact that y particular derived once is nothing but u y1 plus v y2. We carry out another differentiation. And write down yp double dashed. So we'll do that differentiation later. We've held one condition. This is there. So we'll rub out a part of the board and write oh, we lost something. The part of yp first prime is u v1 dashed plus v u1 dash. Dash means prime, first derivative. So if we differentiate this once again, we will get another condition. So differentiating that once again, we'll find y double dashed sub p is equal to u b1 double dashed plus b1 dashed u dashed plus v dashed u1 dashed plus v u1 double dash. This is the second condition or the second derivative. Now, what we have to do is we have to substitute this value and this value into the original equation, and that will give us one more condition. Once we do all that algebra, the condition that emerges is substituting these expressions into the original equation yields